good traveler has no fixed plans and is not intent on arriving. I figured that might be a good sentiment for this latest Stampbord piece that I cover in this video. It's an ATC-sized Stampbord tile. And used on it is the covered bridge stamp, which is roughly the size of the tile. I don't know. I say tile because it's ceramic, but it's really a board. But I just felt like doing another Stampbord piece and playing around a little bit differently with the colors on this one. The thing that I use on it is alcohol-based markers. I happen to just color directly using the plume permanents. A lot of other brands of alcohol-based markers, and they provide a lot of control in going into, you know, the specific areas of the tile. And I wanted to see specifically how the alcohol inks laid down and how they allowed you to go back in and do reversed marks using the scraper knives, scratch knives, scraper tools. And it did. They act differently from scratching into dye-based inks. The alcohol-based inks are a little bit, they're a little bit stiffer, and when you lay them down, you have to scratch into them a little bit more firmly, because the alcohol inks lay on the surface and dry, whereas the dye-based inks kind of lay on the surface, but they absorb into the clay as well. And when they dry, they're, they don't alter the surface of the tile as much. But that being said, you can get a nice clean scratch into the surface areas to reveal you know, some really specific marks as far as little scratches go. And something like a structure like this, things like this little mark right here makes some great little textures, you know, as far as wood grain goes, gives it kind of a rustic feel. I laid down some scratches right here in the grassy areas, and when you scratch into it, it reveals a very white scratch. You see those little scratch marks up there? As opposed to the dye-based inks, when they absorb into the, you know, surface of the Stampbord a little bit, when you scratch into it, it doesn't reveal white as much as it does a lighter version of whatever color is laying on the surface. Again, because it's of the penetrative nature of it, it just soaks in a little bit more. I really laid down some pigment ink in here to soften up some of the very specific scratch marks. Made with the scratch knives, and I found that that works really well to kind of add a little bit of a textural change and to just kind of mellow things out a little bit. I did the other Stampbord, and I don't know, this is what I did. I added some little softer pigment ink marks to it with Colorbox pigment ink, just to kind of introduce that other texture. Otherwise, you know, things get really very sharp in terms of the overall textural quality, and I like to have a range of textures in my scenes, you know, be it on paper or these boards. So anyways, a fun little project. It's a really simple composition, of course, and it's just using two stamps. It was, again, the covered bridge and this Reed's large stamp. The smaller one would work good too, but anyways, just happen to have that one on my desk. And you know, as far as this rendering of the road goes, I used a lot of different inks in there, and just kind of adding in that scratched out texturing over the textured alcohol inks, I thought worked pretty well. You know, without these little scratch marks in here, I think it would look kind of muddled, I guess you can say, with all those little, I don't know, dabbed, you know, alcohol inks, alcohol ink marks. So, quite a bit of an experiment for me as far as the usage of them goes on a different surface. But I had fun. So, anyways, if you watch this video, I hope you enjoy it, and thanks again for tuning into the Stampscapes channel. Okay, let's try and do a pretty fast card today, or project. I'm going to be using the ATC Stampbord size tile. And I'm inking up our covered bridge stamp. I just used a black ink on it. And to go for some variation, I'll be taking a Marvi brush marker, which is a dye-based marker, and adding some green into the trees. Okay. It's a kind of a very basic green, kind of a dark green. But the thing is, if I just color those trees just using the green, you know, doing the whole thing with pens and coloring that green, coloring that brown, you know, or something like that, grass green, I find that it looks a little bit fragmented in the impression, so it's good to get kind of, for me, I like getting one color down, kind of a neutral or universal color, I guess. In this case, it was the black. And then, you know, where I use this green, it still might read as kind of black, but it'll have a greenish tinge to it. I like that look better than having kind of all these isolated kind of subjects of color within one impression. Let's see. This is a brown tone. I'll add that to the bridge just to get a little bit of variation in there as well. And as with most scenes, I'll be introducing most of the color with the use of a kind of a, you know, a color scheme. In whatever coloring method I'm going to be using. It could be dye-based inks. I was thinking about using more of the alcohol-based pens on this project. Okay, now, the ATC board pretty much covers the entire stamp, or I should say the stamp will be covering most of the board, so this will be, for the most part, you know, just a one or two stamp impression project. Okay, here we go. A lot of black in it, but up here it's kind of a greenish black. Okay, so there's not a lot of variation, but it's there's a subtle variation, which I like, you know, because I don't want the transitions to be so sharp in the imagery. Okay. Let me see. Putting my cover back on the surface. If you don't know what tack and peel is, you can check out that video in our YouTube video selections. Oh, okay. I'm kind of waiting for this to set up and absorb a little bit. Stampbord, again, is a soft clay surface, and it's absorbent, but it's very smooth to the surface, and it gives you a nice clean impression. I'm waiting for this to dry a little bit, because when I start going on with the alcohol-based pens over the dye-based inks, even though they're of two different kind of binders, that shouldn't mix and blur with the use of one another, you know, overlapping or coating one. If the dye-based ink is wet, it will smear. Okay. Now, let's see here. Okay, let me just give it a test. I don't want to wait for this to dry. I'm just going to go straight in. I'm starting light, which is my general method of working. Okay, it's picking up some of the black, but not too bad. I'm starting light with this, and I'll work into some darker tones. Okay, it's picking up some of the green a little. No big deal. Okay, maybe I can hit some of these rocks down here, or the... kind of the bank of the stream. Go into the road here, this dirt road. You can see it's kind of smearing a little bit, but that's all right. You can kind of wait for this to dry, or you can take a like a heat gun to set it up a little bit faster. But, that's, I don't know. I don't feel it's going to be that big of a deal. Okay. I don't want it to really smear, just, you know, with harsh, you know, black smudges or something like that. No, I'm just kind of wiggling that, ink off, and it, you know, that comes right off of the, tip there. Okay, now, that was some kind of, I don't know, warm beige, I guess. And let's keep working in that color scheme. I'm getting a little bit darker with this color. I'm going to start going in the... Well, let's see, why don't we go for the vertical sides of the bridge, and I can hit the interior too. That's quite a bit darker than the previous one. Let me go with a little bit of extra tone here, down here on the road. Maybe I don't cover up everything that I colored with the other color. You know, the first color. I don't know the names of these colors, so I'm just going to have to refer to them as the first or second color that I used, or the last color. The bottom line is that, to me, as you can see, the colors don't matter too much. I mean, this is not planned, and I'm kind of grabbing, you know, colors that kind of look similar, and I'm just kind of using them as a family of tones that I think will blend in with one another just fine. If they look like they're kind of similar on the cap or the, you know, that little... I don't know, signifier of color, that should blend on the board just fine. Okay, I'm going for maybe underneath the eaves here to make that a little bit darker. Maybe the shadow is kind of falling on the sides a little bit. Let's try some of this. This is a kind of a more neutral, I don't know, what, brown tone, I guess. Okay. I'm trying to change the hue. I'm trying to bring some variation to the scene and to the volumes. Like, say, the light is coming from the front, so maybe this front of this will be lighter than the side, so I'm kind of adding some of this darker color on the side, just so it looks more, when you change the values of each side of the volume, I feel it looks more, I don't know, gives it a more three-dimensional representation. Alright, let's see here. I was going to say, I might add more later. Let's add it right now. I'm kind of picking some extra colors. Okay, that's a little bit more of a warmish brown. Oh, let's see here. Let's add some more to this road. The road really needs some additional color, doesn't it? Kind of scribbling around. I'll blend it in later, you know, as you can do with alcohol-based pens. Kind of use the blending tool. Blending tool, or you can use just the lighter color and go back in and kind of smooth out those darker ones, you know. I have a... I'm trying to work variation into that road, so, I mean, the road isn't just one value of brown, as you can see, you know, which we don't want. I think that would be too monotonous in a given space to do that. Okay, let's move into some blue tones. I think that's kind of blue. Okay, and here's some greens we'll also use. This, that. Here's a little bright blue. Yeah, let's see, let's give that a shot. Go in the sky with it. I've used these, pens, by the way, on you know, different scenes that I've kind of colored in the you know, the method that I usually use, which is the dye-based inks, you know, the sponging method. And I've used these pens to kind of embellish. I don't know if I've used them just as the sole coloring method, though. Not in a video. I'm trying to remember if I've done that before, but anyway, so this is as much an experiment for me as anything else. You know, it could be that there's be a more effective way to use these. You know, you can certainly use that, you know, airbrushing method, which is, you know, a fantastic method, you know, with your alcohol pens. Let's see what I can do by hand, though. I'm using it in the same way that I do to use the dye-based inks, though. You know, kind of in a light-to-dark fashion. Which may not be, like I said, the most effective way. Okay, now I'm bringing this blue into the trees because blue and yellow, you know, mix to form green. So I want to kind of, you know, have a little bit of unity and cohesive, you know, cohesion between the two different areas, you know, between sky and tree, you know, suggesting that, you know, a similar light is hitting, you know, the entire scene. And I do plan to go into this scene and to reintroduce things like highlights and additional texture. Okay, that was a fairly dark, well, it's more medium tone green, I guess. Let's try this one. I think this one's, yeah, this one's more of a yellowish green. Very bright and warm. Really kind of stands out, doesn't it? I'm gonna have to go back in with a lighter pen of some sort, color, and kind of blend that in a little bit. Kind of mellow it out a touch. But it adds that kind of warm kind of pop to the scene. Let's see, this is the blue again. Let's use that as kind of a blending mechanism. Going on here with it, see, I'm kind of coloring it in right here, see that, where it's kind of darker, and if I kind of use this, you know, such as the nature of alcohol inks, it starts to lift it off, you know, so I can go in and reclaim some lighter value within, you know, a darker space or object. Which is good, because it's giving me a little bit more variation. Not that I'm trying to erase what I've already done, I'm just trying to give some variation to how it looked, you know, after I've laid a color down, kind of in strategic areas. Is there an exact area? No. Just, I'm trying to just create variation across the scene. Kind of gives it that watercolory look as one of the things, the benefits of alcohol inks does. Okay, here comes some blue again. I want to add some of this blue into the water area. That road is looking okay, but I want to create a little bit of a change in hue, I guess, from road to bridge. So let's red it up a touch in the bridge. Okay, now I don't want it to be a red bridge, although you could, but in this case, I'm just going to add a light version of red, which is, of course, pink. And let me test that out a little bit. I don't want it to be a pink bridge. I just want to use a color, like I said, that will, you know, have a relationship with that brown, because they share the same browns. But let's just, like I said, let's create a little bit of a difference in that, okay? Alright, looks okay. Why don't we bring some of this into the meadow? Now, I know I wanted to make some changes, but here I'm putting a few little, you know, bits of that pink into here just to give it, you know, I want separation, but I also want it to have, you know, some relationship with that. Alright. There's that brick down there on the underneath the bridge. I'm going to make them brown. And I'm going to add the shadows under the bridge with brown as well. Okay, that green's looking a little bright to me, and the shadows, oops, grabbed the wrong pen. Let's grab a kind of a dark green. Let's add some shadows down underneath the trees. Creates variation within the spaces and on the shapes. Now, when I go back into, when I did the green, I'm going to go, and this is a gray right here. I don't know. This is not a formula. I'm just kind of going with a color that was lighter than the previous color, which is that dark green. This gray is kind of a neutral gray, medium tone, medium value gray. But I think that will be a good blending color. Put some grays down in the shadows. Maybe underneath the bridge. Yeah. That little white area in the bridge is kind of bothering me. Those windows. Let's pretend we can see through the other side of those windows. Let's see. If we're looking through those windows back in here, I don't know, vents or whatever, I think we'd be able to see some of the green of those trees back there. So let's do some of that green back in there. And let's see, these little slats are looking through some of those slats on the other side of the bridge, but some of them might be kind of obscured. Here's a kind of an olive green that might look good in the mix. I like using kind of an olive colored green whenever I'm using kind of really bright greens. It covers, but you know, you still get the benefit from having that undercolor of, you know, brightness, but you can just kind of mellow it out using kind of more earthy colors, like if you're using oranges or hot pinks or something like that. If you use kind of a brown or something like that, it kind of mellows everything out, but it still looks very rich. Alright. Kind of weird looking a little bit, but we're not done. Okay. Such is the nature of Stampbord, we can go in and introduce a lot of different details to it. There's a little bit of similarity in the water. Let's go in and bring in some variation, I think, to that water area. What I'm doing is I'm kind of adding some shadows to some of those rocks. Now, alcohol inks dry pretty quick, so I don't need to really do too much to this. As far as letting it set up and dry, let's see. I'm trying to think if I want something else in there for now. And I don't think there is, so let's go in and add some details. Okay, let's start off with some of these trees. I was doing that video yesterday and the night before using the Stampbord and butterfly, and when you start scratching this, as I've mentioned in other Stampbord videos, this kind of process is, it's really quite relaxing. I have a feeling that you're using a different part of your brain or something like that, a subtractive process. But I kind of lost track of time, and I didn't realize the video got that long. It was only when I kind of started uploading it to YouTube that I looked at the upload time or the play time, and I was kind of shocked that it went that long. Okay, I'm highlighting, you know, some of these areas on the trees, allowing the some of these I guess clusters of leaves to be capturing some light. One of the things that I'm noticing here too is as I do this, I'm hitting the white of the board, whereas if I did this with dye-based inks kind of penetrate the board a little bit, you know, the clay. So when I stamp, you know, if I was scratching into a green area coated with dye-based inks, as I scratch into it, a dark green, it starts to reveal kind of a lighter green underneath it, and then eventually you get to the white of the board where the alcohol inks kind of, they scratch off, they're on the surface a little bit more, they're more surface oriented, so I find that when I'm scratching in this, I'm just hitting kind of the white of the board, which is fine. It's a little bit of a different feel and look result. Okay, giving some variation to those trees right there throughout here. It looks like there's a little bit more of an element of light and shimmer in here now. Okay. This is using the spoon-shaped scratch knife, speedball scratch knife tip. Go into the water, and in the impression, there's kind of these rocks sitting in the water, and what I'm going and doing is I'm kind of re-establishing those forms that are kind of lost a little bit with all of the coloring that I did, which is different than just simply not coloring it in at all. It'd be tough to kind of leave these little specks of rocks just bare, you know, sans any color, because they're so fine. So it's just easier just to go back in and reintroduce those with a little you know, scratch of the knife right there. Okay, now there were some rock farms that were in the grassy area too that were lost. So I'm going to go back in and reintroduce those as kind of lighter forms, lighter objects. There was this fence back in here. Let me try to. There was one on each side of the entranceway. Kind of going in and just scratching off some of the color off of those so that it just stands out a little bit. See it kind of coming out more now. Okay, let's do the same thing on the road. Let's add some kind of sparkle and texture. Now these highlights are everywhere. I mean, wherever you're sitting at your desk right now, if you just look up and you see the things that light is kind of reflecting off of, you know, I can look at this pen right here and you see these reflections right here and here. You know, if I go right down here, there's a light reflecting off that. Just about anything. I mean, if you put this right here, you have light reflecting off this little area right here especially. And that's what I'm kind of doing, you know, here. If you hold up the light, there's little reflections down this way, right? Even down that little bit right there. And that gives your forms kind of a three-dimensional feel to them, seeing that light isn't just hitting a flat object. And that's how you can kind of bring in that dimension. You can scratch it away on here. You can use a, you know, white gel pen if you want. You can do both for different textures. Okay. Can see this road up here. Little highlights, then as it moves up in there, I have a few kind of in that area. Let's switch up here. Well, let's see. Let's create a little bit of depth by doing kind of larger little highlights on here, kind of in the foreground where it's closer to you, and as you move back, my little scratchy dot highlights might get smaller, kind of reiterating the idea of depth within given space. Now, I'm kind of curious to know how the sky will look if I use this fiber brush. Let's see how this fiber brush works on the alcohol-based inks. Let's give some wispy kind of clouds. Let's create those in the sky. Sorry. This is a little space up here. Kind of rectangular in shape where we have some sky. I'm kind of just going with that same shape and, you know, I'm kind of arcing the clouds in that direction. Let's have some behind these trees. Some of that same kind of wispy soft texture in the background. I'm not going over the trees too much, but I am going over them a little bit. I'm not worried about them disappearing. It's kind of adding a lot of movement and texture into the scene. Wisps down in the water just to create a little bit of a relationship between kind of the sky and you know, reflective area, which would be the water. Let's see, let's go into the rooftop a little bit. How about down here on the road too? We'll add kind of that same, you know, or at least a touch of some of that same wispy texturing. Kind of what I'm doing is scumbling. At least that's what they used to call it in oil painting class. Kind of take a dry brush and kind of, you know, scumble around with. I'm not adding to this, but I'm kind of doing a subtractive process. I like that what's going up there, but it's a little bit too much texture for me. Too much movement. I'm going to take some dye-based ink. Okay, this is a salvia blue, and I'm going to mellow that out a little bit up top. Okay. Because I want to have the movement, but I don't want there to be. I don't want it to be so loud of a texture. Okay. That's doing the trick here, and this is kind of doing that vignetting concept, I guess, here too, so that looks a little bit better to me, I think. Yeah. Okay, let's vignette a little bit down here too. Alright. Now, one thing that I was going to wait and see if it needed it is a little bit of foreground. I have my reeds large here. I do want to have some sort of a visual lead-in to the bridge. And we'll put something really close to us, representatively close, in the form of these reeds right here. Okay. I'll leave a little bit of opening there for the viewer's eye. Now let's switch up now. We have our kind of sharp-tipped scratch knife. And that's for those uniform lines. Uniform scratches. Very small and go in and get some other areas of those trees in a very detailed fashion. Those little scratches right in there with this tip. And I'm gonna do the same over in these areas, okay? It's something that the spoon shape one just can't do, you know. Of course, this sharp one can't do what the spoon one does, so that's why Speedball kind of packages those two together. There aren't too many, you know, formal scratchboard nibs. I've seen about probably four different types. There's one that looks like a butterfly knife, albeit a kind of a mini version. Then there's the spoon one that I just used, and this sharper one. And I've seen other ones, kind of primarily like this one, the sharp tip. But other people use other things. They use sandpaper, you know, to not, you know, on Stampbord so much, but on larger boards to achieve different types of textures and marks. Okay, there were a few more rocks. As I'm doing this, it occurs to me that I can see a few more these rocks in the grassy area that need to be revealed, I think, for additional texture within that space, just so it looks better. Same thing on the road. Okay, that looks better. Have some of these rocks kind of lit up, top lit, and by having that texture in that grassy area and on the road, it's bringing continuity to these two separate areas within the stamp image. Having that cohesion, it just looks better like that, you know, by having, you know, some of that area that's over here, it's highlighted, and same thing over here on these on this meta road. That being said, even small areas like this on the these bricks down here, it can use some different highlights. You know, you can just kind of light up some, you know, bringing some of that on there, bringing some of that texture and lighting scheme. It brings visual continuity to the scene. The rooftop doesn't have anything. It doesn't have any really variation, so when I go and you know, just kind of highlight one of these slat or two or three, and bring variation to it. Okay, it's not just so flat. And see these slats on the side of the bridge. It looks okay. There's variation as far as color goes, but let's just kind of come into it and bring a little bit more variation. Could be variation and randomness to it. Just having a few little of those slats kind of lit. Actually, that one looks kind of weird. Let's try with the let's bring in the sharp one. Why don't we add a little bit of texture? You know, would we be able to see texture from this distance? You know, if it was in a you know, if we were in a real setting, and the answer would be no. You know, of course not. But we're not trying to just replicate nature or something that, you know, would be more appropriate for a camera. Okay, so there we go. A little bit of texturing using the sharp point, and maybe I'll do some of that on the rooftop as well. Kind of going in the direction of the slats. Okay, let's see. I just realized I smeared a lot of this, these reeds here, kind of putting my hand on. I forgot that I just stamped those out. Or I don't know, I didn't forget, I just wasn't thinking about it. Let's go up and highlight them a little bit with this sharp, fine-tipped scratch knife. Okay, now I want to add a little bit of vignetting to the scene. Let's go with, you know, a dark blue. What's that? Kind of hit the four corners of the tile with it. This is a number 3 blue from Marvy. It's pretty dark. Some pinks and greens in there. I think that a few little wildflowers would look cool. This is a pink Sharpie paint pen. Nothing like a few little wildflowers. Fairly subtle. Kind of right alongside the road. Pearly Everlasting. These little white flowers, maybe. Putting some up some highlights here in these trees as well. Maybe it's a little shimmering light, or maybe it's, you know, some sort of flowering element on the tree and bushes. pedestrian on the road. Let's see. Let's add some of these down. I could scratch this off too, but I want to add some of these more, you know, straight rounded forms of the dot, along with the kind of more scratched marks of the scratch tool, scraper boards, or scraper tools. Let's finish it off with some additional texture. We have a lot of sharp scratches and little pinpoints of pinpoint highlighting with the stylus tool. See that right there? Kind of, this pad here is fairly wet, so I'm working at kind of observing the consistency of the ink. As I tap it off, I'm going for something kind of soft and easy to apply, meaning it's kind of a little bit on the dry side. Okay, see a little mist in there. Let's put a little mist over here as you're kind of, you know, going towards the bridge, or the entrance of the bridge. And let's say there's a little bit of a fine hovering mist on the ground. A bit too much, so I'm kind of removing some of it. How about, you know, some on the other side of the stream? Distance. Kind of gives it more of a, I don't know, I think kind of a magical look to it when you have this kind of illuminated mist. That's why they use fog machines and things like that on, you know, from stage and whatever, movies. Kind of softens things and kind of brings the viewer's attention to, you know, the main subject or star of the scene too. Trying to balance it off a little bit. If you ever had too much of this, you can always go in and remove some. Just rub it right off the surface with your finger or, you know, paper towel, something like that. It won't mess up your scene or the coloring job you've done. Okay, let's see. I think that's it. Looks okay to me. Yeah. Obscure this point a little bit more. kind of removing some of that ink right in there. I don't like it. Okay. Okay. Stampbord. Covered bridge in the mist, I guess. Okay, I'll spray this and we'll mount it up and we'll see what it looks like. Quick scene. Most of the, you know, the work was in the finish, as it always is, but two stamps can make a nice, complete, and full composition as far as scene goes. Thanks for watching, and hope you enjoyed the project.